Welcome to the WWE Podcast, the most passionate and authentic wrestling analysis on the web. We've got you covered with every Raw, SmackDown, and NXT show, giving you a no bullshit opinion. We know you love wrestling. We do too. So let's get this show underway.
And that's the bottom line. What? Because Stone Cold said so.
All right, everybody, welcome back to another edition of the SmackDown Review here on the WWE Podcast. As always, I'm your host, Michael Ritter, and today we're going to be talking about the SmackDown that aired on December 4th, 2020. This is actually the 10th SmackDown review that I'm going to be doing here for the WWE Podcast. It's actually pretty cool for me. I mean, time is flying by. It does not seem like it's been 10 weeks, but it definitely has. It's kind of just like a little personal milestone for me to get to 10 episodes. I mean, it just seems like yesterday was my first time. It probably still sounds like it's my first time to all you guys. I appreciate y'all bearing with me here. But getting into the SmackDown that aired on December 4th, before we do that, though, I want to make sure to let you guys know that at the end of the episode, there's going to be another top five for you. This time it's going to be the top five theme songs from the Ruthless Aggression Era. As always, it is a completely subjective list, just my top five. These songs vary from, you know, just songs that I thought were catchy to songs that I thought fit that character well to songs that just literally stuck in my head when I was in the fourth grade and like still can't get them out to this day. So if you're a fan of the Ruthless Aggression Era or just a fan of music in general, then you might actually really like this top five, so you might want to stick around for that. But getting into the SmackDown review, which is why most of you are here, and this one started with the entire locker room, including Vince McMahon, standing on the stage to pay tribute to the late Pat Patterson, doing the 10-bell salute, which you've seen them do for many wrestlers who passed away over the years. And this death in particular, Pat Patterson, seemed to really hit home, you know, pretty hard to a lot of the wrestlers on the active roster. You've seen a lot of them take to social media to, you know, show their support and their condolences to his family and friends in the wrestling industry. I mean, he was definitely a pillar, kind of. I mean, there's not sure how true it is, but I mean, there's people that are saying that he's the one that created the Royal Rumble. They dedicated a match later in the show, a six-man tag match with all former Intercontinental Champions to honor him as an Intercontinental Champion in the past. He's one of the most famous Intercontinental Champions. So definitely want to send my condolences to Pat Patterson's family and all of his fans, friends. I know that this was definitely a tough one for a lot of the people in the wrestling industry to swallow. So I hope that everybody is handling that all right. But continuing on here with Kayla Braxton, she starts the show, welcomes us all to SmackDown, and that is followed by an exclusive interview with Roman Reigns. And Roman comes to the ring, and I'm starting to really, I don't know, I mean, just the way that Paul Heyman stares at Roman Reigns, I've mentioned this before, every week it seems to get on my nerves even more. I mean, I just don't understand. I don't feel like that adds anything to the character. I mean, it's seriously distracting. When Roman comes out, I'm just staring at Paul Heyman because he cannot take his eyes off Roman. It's definitely something that, I don't know, I mean, it's just one of those little things that kind of bother me. Definitely don't want to start the show off on a bad foot, but that's just one of the things I wrote here in my notes. Just, it's just awkward when you're watching it. Even whenever Jey Uso was there, I mean, he was just staring at him. I'm not sure what exactly that is. I mean, is he just obsessed with him or something? I mean, Paul Heyman seems to only talk whenever Roman tells him to, but other than that, I mean, he just, whenever he walks out to the ring, he's just staring at him and admiring him, and I don't know, just something about that. Maybe it'll grow on me. Maybe I'll stop getting frustrated whenever I see it. I know it's something small. But anyway, Let's see here. She gives Roman a pretty lengthy introduction, mentioning all of his accolades, all of his championships. Basically just a quick introduction of what he's done. And then whenever he does get out there, she asks him what happened last week. And they show a video package of what happened last week with Kevin Owens in the main event with Jey Uso. And she asks him, after that, she asks if, after avoiding confrontation, does he fear Kevin Owens? And he actually gets pretty upset by that. He says that she used the biggest moment to date in her career to ask a stupid question. And then he continues to verbally go at Kayla Braxton after she asked another question, which was, I think she asked if he's being manipulative. And he says something along the lines that that's a stupid word for a stupid person or something like that. He even apologized, says he didn't mean, he's not trying to be rude. He might not have apologized, but he definitely kind of backtracked a little bit and said, you know, he's not trying to be rude or insult her or anything. But he then tells Paul Heyman, that is, to handle this amateur. And then Paul takes the mic and he begins to answer some rhetorical questions about the recent success of SmackDown's ratings, saying that they're correlating directly to Jey Uso main event in SmackDown almost every week for the past several months. But before he can go on much further, he's interrupted by Kevin Owens, who comes out to challenge Roman Reigns for a match at TLC for the Universal Championship. But he also says that if Roman didn't want to wait to TLC, that they could do it right now. And Roman says that the old him would have kicked Kevin Owens' ass right then, but he is not a savage, and he's respectful. That there's a lady in the ring talking about Kayla Braxton, and he tells Kevin Owens to grow up, and he leaves the ring, but as he's walking up the ramp, Kevin Owens stops him and basically calls him a bitch for not accepting his challenge. And WWE actually is really loving that word here recently. It actually gets mentioned again later in the show, and they say it, or they said it last week, Roman Reigns did, but it's kind of hard to give you guys the full analysis without basically saying what they're saying. I feel like they're throwing that in there for a particular reason. They might just want to make the show a little more edgy, make the superstars a little more edgy to, I honestly don't know what exactly the cursing adds, but I mean, I'm not complaining about it at all. Like I said before, I think that's pretty cool. It kind of reminds me of the old days whenever that happened a lot more often. I know it's a different time in wrestling and things just aren't quite what they used to be, but I mean, a couple curse words really are not hurting anybody. I mean, they're not going around just dropping F-bombs or anything like that. I mean, they wouldn't even say the A-word a little bit later in the show with Otis and Kevin Owens. But anyway, before I get too off topic here, after that's over, the segment with Kayla Braxton, Roman Reigns, and Paul Heyman and all them in the ring, we get a backstage segment with Roman Reigns and Jey Uso. And Jey's kind of rambling on about how Kevin Owens is being out of line by disrespecting them. And Roman says that he knows that Jey meant well, but he wants Jey to remember that there's consequences for everything that they do. Those consequences actually come up a little bit later in the night, so we will get to that. But after this, we get a one-on-one match between Bayley and Natalya with Bianca Belair as a guest commentator. This match was kind of, it definitely went different than I expected. Bayley tapped out clean to Natalya. I did not expect that at all. Bianca Belair, I mean, if you want to count her kind of standing on the outside of the ring, just taunting Bayley a little bit as interference, I certainly do not count that as interference. So in my book, this was definitely a clean win for Natalya. I'm not exactly sure why they would do, or they would give Natalya the win over Bayley. Bayley is clearly the more valuable asset to the company right now. It must just be, I mean, you could say that it must be to continue this collision course that Bayley and Bianca are on, but you would think that maybe Bianca would interfere more drastically to further that angle if that's the way they were going. But they didn't. This was definitely more in the ballpark of a clean win. So I don't really feel like it furthers that feud between Bianca and Bayley. I mean, obviously, that's still the direction they're going, which I think is pretty cool. It being a non-title women's feud, you usually don't really see those. At least WWE put much value into them. So to have Carmella and Sasha have their thing going on, and then clearly seeing Bianca and Bayley having their own thing going on, I think that this is the first time that I can remember, and I'm probably wrong, but that WWE has given us two decent women's feuds at the same time, much less on the same brand. But I'm definitely enjoying what I'm seeing from the women's division on SmackDown so far. But like I said, this match right here just kind of caught me off guard with the outcome. I'm excited to see kind of what happens next week to see if maybe Bayley gets some revenge to get some type of upper hand on Bianca. But Natalya just seems to be a prop in this feud, so she's probably going to get featured in the weeks to come as this storyline gets deeper. But next we get the Pat Patterson tribute match, which was a six-man tag match. Big E, Daniel Bryan, and Rey Mysterio versus Sami Zayn, Shinsuke, and Dolph. I think the one thing that everybody noticed in this match was Big E's new theme song, and he's going back to doing the powder toss entrance. I actually never seen him do that before. That was probably before I came back to start watching wrestling, but I've heard multiple people allude to him doing that in the past, and even Corey Graves did on the broadcast as well. So, you know, I trust them enough to know that it's definitely something that he has done in the past. But during this match, I thought that Daniel Bryan, Big E, and Sami Zayn all looked very impressive. Rey Mysterio is obviously a legend, so inside the ring, it's no surprise that he can still go bell to bell with the best. But I feel like this match definitely over-delivered. These guys must have really taken it being advertised as a tribute to Pat Patterson very seriously, because they made it very entertaining from start to finish. I noticed a lot in this match that Sami Zayn's character is really starting to translate to his in-ring style more and more every week, and he's perfecting this role. It's kind of just being that chicken you know what. He's embracing it, and I feel like it can or he can ride this character and just keep building heat all the way through WrestleMania season, and hopefully hold on to that Intercontinental Championship, and we can get a lengthy feud leading up to WrestleMania. But I think Sami's doing a great job with that Intercontinental Championship, and I'm anxious to see who can take it off of him. But I'm not going to lie, I got the vibes with kind of what the announced team was saying during the match. They were really putting the focus on Big E. So my gut is telling me that Big E is in fact going to be the one to take that title off of Sami. I could see it happening anywhere from TLC to one of the pay-per-views leading up to WrestleMania. I'm kind of talking myself out of the Sami Zayn holding the title now that I realize that Big E is certainly kind of getting that kickstart. I mean, they're not going to do anything too quick. It's definitely going to be a slow kind of piece-by-piece transformation into a new character. But now that I see that they're actually taking those steps, it does put a lot more believability in Big E. I know that he was actually left off my top five list last week for the superstars who were set to have a big 2021. And I definitely considered putting him on that list. But the main reason I did not was because the hesitation to, I guess, commit to this new character by the WWE. So I felt like the superstars that I did put on that list had more of a chance. And, you know, some of them still might. But if they are going to commit to this new character for Big E, I feel like he is somebody who can definitely have a huge 2021. But getting back to this six-man tag match here, after a series of failed pinfall attempts by Sami and Daniel, Daniel Bryan eventually rolls Sami up with an inside cradle to win the match. So it's safe to say that at least 50% of the matches, and that's, you know, at least 50% of the matches, end in some sort of roll-up, which is something that everyone notices now, especially if you listen to this show, you're well aware of it, which is pretty unfortunate considering how much this match did overdeliver as far as what my expectations were for it. But one thing that definitely jumped off the screen to me is, can we please get Big E a new finisher? I mean, he is way too strong. He has the physique to just do anything that all these other big guys are doing, yet we have him. I mean, he, like, legitimately, if there was a power rankings for finishing moves in the WWE, there is no way that his is even in the top 50. I mean, that might be a little bit of an exaggeration, but probably not if you actually started listening to him. I mean, his move is just completely boring. It looks absolutely ineffective. I'm not sure how creative Vince McMahon, anybody in the back, can see him do that move and think that that is the right move for Big E. So hopefully, as his character gets more serious, they can add some type of new move, or maybe an entire new move set, which I doubt. They'll probably just maybe tweak it a little bit, but we got to get him a new finisher to really solidify him as the badass that he is. And up next, we got the first and only backstage segment with Caleb Braxton. It is with Kevin Owens. And she asks Kevin Owens just what it is about Roman that draws his ire. And he says that what upsets him the most about Roman is that he used to respect him. He acknowledges that he himself isn't perfect, but he says that Roman is a self-absorbed, arrogant jackass. And this is kind of whenever Otis walks up, and I don't know if it's just me. I mean, you guys can definitely go back and watch this to tell me if I'm wrong here, but Otis seemed like he was talking differently than he normally does. I mean, it was a noticeable change in the way Otis was speaking. It was clear. It was understandable. He didn't seem like he was, you know, squinting his eyes, looking both directions, which, I mean, that really didn't bother me too much just because, I mean, I never really took Otis's character that serious to begin with, but I just definitely noticed that there was something different about him. And even whenever he comes out, I mean, they're referring to him as the blue collar brawler. And obviously with the heavy machinery split, he did get the new song. So, I mean, I just don't know really if they're doing something different with Otis. I mean, you guys all know about the Alpha Academy. We didn't see any Chad Gable this week, but that's something to still keep in the back of your mind, that that could have something to do with this new Otis. If, in fact, we are getting a new Otis, we didn't get to see much about it or much of Otis in his match later on tonight, which is in the main event, and we'll get to why. But that's something to just definitely keep your eye on, because Otis could be on the way to getting some new things happening to him as a character in general. And up next was another segment that I actually really enjoyed. Whenever they said it was going to happen, I was actually really looking forward to this interview. It's one of the classic split-screen virtual Jumbotron interviews where both wrestlers just kind of go back and forth. And that's exactly what this was between Sasha and Carmella. Michael Cole starts by asking Sasha if her and Carmella are more alike than she thinks. Carmella interrupts and answers by calling Sasha a Nicki Minaj wannabe. Sasha says that she's always been out of Carmella's league. Carmella calls her jealous and refers to herself as the hot chick who's going to embarrass her and take her championship. And Sasha eventually gives her a title match at TLC. Now, I know that the way I just explained that kind of, you know, downplayed it a little bit. This was actually a pretty good segment. If you didn't see this, I would recommend watching it because I can't go word for word on what was said. It was a lot of back and forth, things getting a little personal, but overall a good interview that did further the storyline and confirm the anticipated match at TLC for the SmackDown Women's Championship. But like I said, I mean, this was just basically, you know, a typical kind of catfight type argument, but there were some, you know, some good things said. I don't want to, you know, downplay this. Like I said, I really liked, you know, what I saw from Sasha, what I saw from Carmella. I felt like there was some truth into what they were saying. I think Carmella does have, you know, a new confidence that's just oozing out of her. You can tell when she's on the mic. And part of me wonders if this is the start of a run of successful title defenses for Sasha. It's kind of like the only blemish on her resume is that poor record of defending that championship. Obviously, she's one of the most talented women on the roster, so I feel like why not just put that whole theory to rest by letting her go on a pretty long run of just knocking contenders down as they come. It would be believable. Like I said, she's one of the best women's wrestlers on the whole roster, much less SmackDown. So I see nothing wrong with Sasha going on a long run, but I am pretty excited to see what we can see from Carmella in a actual singles match to see if she can hang with Sasha. Because when Sasha said that she's out of her league, that was 100% the truth. Carmella is somebody who, whenever she was wrestling, I don't even know how long it's been since we've seen her, long before she did this character switch, she was somebody who, it's kind of like Lana, not nearly to the extent of Lana, but it's one of those things. And I actually heard Mimi Burris, one of the newest co-hosts here of the WWE podcast, I heard her reference it on her show, how whenever she sees Lana wrestling in the ring, it kind of, takes the believability out of it. And that's kind of how I got for Carmella back then, whenever she was, still fairly new from the whole Enzo and Cass thing, still doing the James Ellsworth stuff. Just, I feel like there was a lot of, botching going on with her. And she just, really wasn't polished as far as, inside of the ring. She's clearly gotten a lot better since then. But it's one of those things that I want to be able to completely forget that if she's in a match with, say, Bianca Belair, that Bianca would legitimately be able to throw her around the ring. I want to be able to believe that Carmella can stand a chance against her. So we will see. Sasha is definitely a good measuring stick as the first opponent to see where she is, inside the ring. So at TLC, which is really shaping up to be a pretty good card, I'm excited to see what happens with this SmackDown Women's Championship match. Moving on here, we get the Murphy versus Corbin match that we were promised last week on SmackDown when Corbin said that he would be more prepared. We did find out what he meant by that. Murphy had the Mysterios at ringside for him, and Corbin is accompanied to the ring by two individuals in dark hoodies. This match was much more competitive than last week. Corbin actually ate a pretty brutal kick to the face by Murphy in this match, but the two men were revealed to be two members of the Forgotten Sons, whose name couldn't be more true, as I myself completely forgot they even existed. But Blake and Cutler are their names, and things actually went haywire when Blake and Cutler attacked the Mysterios outside of the ring. As everyone was running around the ring and inside the ring, Corbin managed to hit Murphy with the End of Days and pick up the win. This match was actually pretty long. Not, half an hour or anything like that, but it was just one of those matches. As far as everything else on the show, this was probably one of the longest matches, including the six-man tag match and the main event that is following this one. They really put a lot of time into this one, but I actually loved seeing the Mysterios get attacked outside of the ring. I mean, they were kind of just standing there, and the two men in the hoodies just ran up and just attacked them. That's something that I love to see, because there's been so many times where they're the ones who come out and they go out of their way looking for all these problems, but yet they still play like they're the good guy. It felt good for once just to see them be the ones that get attacked, and nobody really cares if they're the good guy or not, because we just all want to see them get their heads kicked in. But anyways, Corbin and Murphy are now tied at 1-1 apiece in the last 2 weeks. But I'm kind of wondering if these guys are going to stick around with Corbin, as far as maybe if this is like a one-off, or if they're actually going to be kind of like some henchmen for him. The fact that they didn't come back in their usual wrestling gear tells me that this could be a new experiment to see if they can get anything out of these guys while they're still collecting a paycheck from WWE. But you never know. I had no idea who these guys were until they were mentioned on the announce team. I didn't know if it was Retribution coming to SmackDown because of the hoodie thing. But like I said, it turned out to be the two members of the Forgotten Sons. And we'll see if they stick around with Corbin or not. but the fact that Corbin and Murphy are 1-1, you can expect at least one more match between these two, whether it happens on SmackDown or TLC. You can definitely expect these two guys to be in the ring together again very soon. But after the Murphy and Corbin match, we get the main event, which is Roman and Jey Uso versus Kevin Owens and Otis. Or that's at least what it was supposed to be. Roman actually did not show up to start the match. He let it begin as a 2-on-1 handicap match. And the beginning went as you would expect. Kevin Owens picking up where he left off last week by continuing to lay the smackdown on Jey Uso. But Roman did eventually show up. And it did not take him very long to take Otis completely out of the match by doing some damage on the outside of the ring, you know, like throwing him over the announce table. And then somehow did not get disqualified after hitting him with the steel steps. That actually caused the tables to turn, making it essentially a 2-on-1 match against Kevin Owens this time. And Jey climbed to the top rope to hit the Uso splash and close out the match, but Roman demanded that he got down and tagged out so that Roman could win the match. And that interaction caused Kevin Owens to recover and regain control by knocking Roman off the apron and hitting Uso with a stunner. But Roman was not down for long because he quickly gets back in the ring to break up the pinfall and then puts Kevin Owens in the guillotine and somehow gets disqualified for that. That was the most confusing part of the entire night. I don't understand how Roman get, or how, because the referee disqualified him almost immediately. As soon as he locked it in, he was like, oh no, this, like, it's almost as if the move was illegal or something. Normally, if the superstar in a tag match who's not legal gets in the match and starts doing something like, you know, putting a submission lock on the opponent, they're going to give them a 5-second count. Is that not the rule? I mean, somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, of course, but is that not the rule? That's what I've always thought was that. I see it all the time. The superstar who's not legal can get in the ring and help his partner out, and he's not going to get disqualified. But he gets disqualified here for putting Kevin Owens in the guillotine, despite using the steps earlier in the match and everything being perfectly fine. Just that type of inconsistency in the rules is very frustrating for me. I don't understand how hard it is. I mean, I really feel like it's them insulting our intelligence. So that's one thing that just kind of grinds my gears a little bit. But I'm not going to get too worked up over that. Because after this match is over, Roman and Jey simultaneously beat Kevin Owens over the back with the steel chairs. And Roman eventually tells Jey to hit the Uso splash with the chair on top of Owens to inflict more damage. So Jey does just that. But what happens after that is really interesting, because Roman actually hit Jey with the chair and begins to put a pretty brutal attack on his cousin. So we thought him showing up late to the match were the quote-unquote consequences that Roman was referring to earlier in the night. But it turns out that he had something much more effective planned if he wants to really get his point across. But Roman actually had some more off-mic work while he was telling Kevin Owens everything he was going to do to him. You can kind of go back and watch that. I don't really recall anybody doing that as much as Roman Reigns has been doing it lately. I think that just kind of adds a dimension to his character, something that he does that not a whole lot of other people do. So it's unique in that aspect. But I can't stress enough how much Roman Reigns is knocking this out of the park. He legitimately feels like a different guy, or at least a different guy than the person I knew from like 2014 to 2019. And I was a huge Roman Reigns fan for that time period. So this is something that's definitely an adjustment, but I am enjoying it. And I am certainly looking forward to seeing it continue in the coming weeks. But that is the show, guys. That's the entire SmackDown. Like I said, this one went by pretty fast. I'm not sure why. But as I was watching it, I was just noticing, like, man, this thing is flying by. So, like I said, that is the SmackDown review, but coming right up, I got the top 5 theme songs of the Ruthless Aggression coming your way. Okay, and here on this top 5, like I said, this is the top 5 theme songs from the Ruthless Aggression era, and my list is probably a lot different than other people's, and then again, it might not be, but these are the songs that either, you know, caught my ear, like I said, or they just relate to that specific character enough to where the song itself was just like entrenched in my memory. So over the past like 16, 17 years, these are still the songs that come to mind whenever I think about this specific era in wrestling. So I'm not really going to say much about it. I mean, there's really not much to say about the songs themselves. I'm kind of just going to go through the list and let you guys know one by one who it is. But we will start here with number 5. Alright guys, and you guys probably recognize that. That was RVD, one of, in my opinion, the most underrated wrestlers from the Ruthless Aggression era, and possibly even all time. His song was definitely true as far as him being one of a kind. There's not been anybody like RVD since, and there might not be one ever again. I mean, he truly was a one of one, and his theme song was pretty good. Not sure if anybody else liked it as much as I did, and it really wasn't until I went back on the WWE Network and was watching a lot of the older Raws with RVD on them that I actually realized how catchy that song really is. So that was number 5. So let's move right along here to number 4. Another one that you guys should have definitely recognized, one of my personal favorites, that's Kane from like 2003 on to, I don't even know how long he kept this song, but it's just one that I'm even kind of disappointed these days. Like Kane was on Survivor Series just this last week with The Undertaker, and every time Kane comes out, and it's kind of like a rendered or kind of like a just a remix version of that song. Just definitely different. It's just one of those little things. Like, I feel like Kane was at his hottest, no pun intended, whenever he was in that just now got unmasked phase of his career with that theme song. That's just whenever I feel like Kane was at the, you know, the height of at least my memory of, you know, just where he was in his career. And he might have had more success, you know, later on whenever he actually did capture the World Heavyweight Championship. But there was a lot of credibility behind that Kane character whenever he did have that theme song. So we will continue on here with number 3. And there you guys go with number 3, Chris Jericho, somebody who, no surprise, has always had good theme songs, someone who has a history and a background in music like Chris Jericho does, he's obviously going to have good taste in that regard. And that's just, I feel like, one of the more underrated songs. It's one that was his theme song for the entire time he was in WWE, at least for the time that I watched. And obviously he has a new song here in AEW that's actually pretty popular too, at least among those fans. But as far as I'm concerned, the Break the Walls Down was always Chris Jericho's best theme song. So, moving on here to number two.
Viva la raza! I lie, I cheat, I steal. I lie, I cheat, I steal. Yo, mamacita, I got that passion to set them on. Los Cojones fall in love with that Latin charm. One woman isn't enough, amigo. Siempre corriendo más mujeres porque soy latino. In a tough and a tough part of your club, cuz I lie, I cheat, I steal. I lie, I cheat, I steal. I don't care if you don't like me. Everybody wants to fight me. You feel it, babe? Oye, lo claro, I ain't the one you wanna meet. Hay nada más caliente, I'm too hot for you. Yo, Latino heat.
And you guys should all recognize that one. That is the late, great Eddie Guerrero. Definitely one of the greatest wrestlers of all time. So, I had to get his song on here. And that's one, like I was referring to, that just completely relates to the character and fits them like a glove. That song, I mean, and a lot of people might argue that the song itself might not be, you know, up to par with maybe some of the other songs on the list or some of the songs that they might have liked from that era. But the main reason why I had to get that one on there and rank it so high is because of the regard that I hold it to, just as far as, like, whenever I hear that song, the memories that kind of come to mind, and just the time in wrestling whenever that song was played basically religiously every week. And it was basically the theme song for some of the, you know, better memories that I have from, like, early 2004, the No Way Out, whenever he won the championship against Brock Lesnar, WrestleMania 20 against Kurt Angle. I mean, the list goes on. So I definitely had to get an Eddie Guerrero reference on this list, and why not just use his song and rank it pretty high at number two? But that leaves us with one more song, and it is the number one spot. So there you go. The number one spot was Triple H, Time to Play the Game. And this song right here is just perfect in my opinion. I mean, you could hear so many different instruments just like from a musical standpoint, as well as just being from a legit heavy metal band like Motorhead. So I was definitely always a big fan of Triple H's theme song. And like I've alluded to before, I didn't get to watch SmackDown a lot growing up. I mean, reruns, pay-per-views was really the only times that I was able to be exposed to SmackDown. So Triple H was one of the only guys that I saw every Monday for 2 to 3 years straight. And whenever you're constantly seeing and listening to the same song, it's obviously going to kind of be stuck in your head. But that's one that really never got old to me. And even as one of the hottest heels, who as a 10-year-old kid, I did not, you know, like Triple H, so to speak. I mean, obviously, I have a different perspective on it now, and I can appreciate how he is one of the greatest heels of all time. But he was so good at his job that he made 10-year-old me absolutely hate him. So it's actually kind of surprising that that song did come in at number one. If I were to tell my 10-year-old self that, he might be a little pissed. But nowadays, I mean, it's no surprise. That song is an absolute banger. So I had to get it on here and put it number one. But as always, I want you guys to let me know what you thought. What songs did I leave off? Which ones did I put on there that should not have been on there? I definitely want to hear from you guys and know what you think. Know if you guys want me to do any more top fives going forward, just what you guys want to hear. Obviously, I'm going to keep doing them. But if there's any suggestions, I would love to get those at Michael 5 Ritter. So just let me know. And that should be about it that I have for you guys today. It's not as late as it usually is, so you don't got to worry about that. I managed to get all this done by 12:30, so I don't have to stay up super, super late tonight. I do have work tomorrow, so back to the regular life. But guys, I appreciate you so much for choosing to listen to this. I hope y'all have a great rest of your weekend. Enjoy NXT War Games. I'm definitely rooting for Pat McAfee. So if he happens to lose, if he happens to win, whatever, I'm just happy that he is getting involved and getting a chance to show what he can do in the wrestling ring. I know he's a huge fan. He actually works. He trains. So that is what I am looking forward to the most about this weekend. There's also the tribute to the troops going on Sunday. So there's a lot of action going on this weekend. So we have basically a pretty good full plate of content coming out. Because, I mean, as soon as Sunday's over, we got Monday Night Raw and a new week coming. So we have a lot to be excited about. But that's all I got for you tonight, guys. So I will talk to you next week.